In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My brothers and sisters, we gather on this fifth week of Ordinary Time on Monday. Today our church asks us to remember Josephine Bakhita. Josephine Bakhita, early 20th century saints, the first Sudanese saint canonized, definitely much more saints from Sudan, but the first one that the Western church has recognized and canonized. So interesting story, sold as a slave as a young girl, and then sold several times. Eventually, an Italian consul buys her, brings her to Italy. She was basically a nanny for probably the consul's daughter, and would take the child to catechism classes. And there she'd listen in and learn about the Christian faith. She comes to believe in Jesus Christ and comes to own the faith herself. She gets baptized. She asks for her freedom, and the law allows her to be granted her freedom. So she's granted her freedom. She ends up joining the women's religious order that was teaching the young child under her care. And I forget the name of that order, but a woman's order that she ends up being noted for just, simplicity, a woman of humility, simplicity of service. And a woman, who so much injustice done to her, to be sold as a slave, to be, mutilated because she's seen as a piece of property, but to hold the love of God in her heart, to be filled with that sense of forgiveness, that sense of reconciliation. And so Pope John Paul II held her up as a model for us, a model in the midst of darkness, to the power of reconciliation, the power of Christ. Today is also the day the church asks us to pray for those caught in human trafficking, the slavery of modern day, that we pray for all those and the end to that violence. So as we prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us be mindful of the blessings we have through our faith and the power that our faith charges us to be people of reconciliation, people of peace, and also people of justice. Lord Jesus, you raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you bring pardon and peace to the sinner. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you bring light to those in darkness. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. And together, let us pray. O God, who led St. Josephine Bakhita from abject slavery to the dignity of being your daughter and the bride of Christ, grant, we pray, that by her example we may show constant love for the Lord Jesus crucified, remaining steadfast in charity and prompt to show compassion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the beginning of the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss, while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw how good the light was. God then separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Thus evening came and morning followed, the first day. Then God said, "Let there be a dome in the middle of the waters, to separate one body of water from the other." And so it happened. God made the dome, and it separated the water above the dome from the water below it. God called the dome the sky. Evening came and morning followed, the second day. Then God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered into a single basin, so that the dry land may appear." And so it happened. The water under the sky was gathered into its basin, and the dry land appeared. God called the dry land the earth, and the basin of the water he called the sea. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth vegetation, every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it." And so it happened. The earth brought forth every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it. God saw how good it was. Evening came and morning followed, the third day. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky, to separate day from night. Let them mark the fixed times, the days and the years, and serve as luminaries in the dome of the sky, to shed light upon the earth." And so it happened. God made the two great lights, the greater one to govern the day, and the lesser one to govern the night. And he made the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. God saw how good it was. Evening came and morning followed, the fourth day. The word of the Lord. May the Lord be glad in his works. May the Lord be glad in his works. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are great indeed. You are clothed with majesty and glory, robed in light as with a cloak. May the Lord be glad in his works. You fixed the earth upon its foundation, not to be moved forever. With the ocean, as with a garment, you covered it. Above the mountains, the waters stood. May the Lord be glad in his works. You send forth springs into the watercourses that wind among the mountains. Beside them, the birds of heaven dwell. From among the branches, they send forth their song. May the Lord be glad in his works. How manifold are your works, O Lord! In wisdom, you have wrought them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Alleluia. May the Lord be glad in his works.
Alleluia, alleluia. Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom of God and cured every disease among the people. Alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. After making a crossing to the other side of the sea, Jesus and his disciples came to land at Gennesaret and tied up there. As they were leaving the boat, people immediately recognized him. They scurried about the surrounding country and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. Whatever villages or towns or countryside he entered, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch only the tassel on his cloak. And as many as touched it were healed. The Gospel of the Lord. Well, we just finished looking at the letter of the Hebrews. That was the first reading for our daily mass for the last couple of weeks. Now we're moving into the book of Genesis, and we'll hear from the book of Genesis until Lent. So we're beginning, of course, with the beginning of Genesis, the creation stories. It's easy to let these creation stories of Genesis, to see them as like, oh, these are nice fables when we were kids, and then just to let them just go past our minds. Oh, I've heard this story before. I can like start to daydream because, you know, nothing new under the sun. But we got to be careful because God sent his word not just for kids, but for all of us. Because God knows we need help. We need guidance. And the wisdom of God is found in God's very words. And these first few chapters of Genesis are very important because they lay those foundational aspects of who God is before us. Without these foundations, it's easy to fall into heresies, to follow the latest fad of what other people are saying. And so I think it's very important to look at this, because our religion is a religion of revelation. It's not a religion where we just sort of think up these ideals of God and we say, okay, God must be this. But it's God revealing God's self to us through prophets, through God's interaction with his chosen people that allows us to understand who our God is, and most especially through Jesus Christ, God becoming flesh. So in the first verse, we see God is alone, that there is only one God. And this implies that if we're to worship or follow another God, we're just following a lie. It can only lead to a dead end or to our self-destruction. It implies the obvious, that we are never alone. God is always with us. This first verse also reveals that God existed before time, that the beginning, namely time zero, is measured with the act of God creating, that there's no time before then, but there was God. So though we exist in time, God clearly exists outside of time. And because of this, it's dangerous to impose our time thoughts on God, or have to miss the mark and to get it wrong. It would be sort of like a deaf person trying to describe the beauty of a Mozart piece, or a blind person trying to describe the beauty of a sunset. Might get aspects of it there, but never fully capture it. And so it calls us to great humility, great reverence of God on our part. Another truth revealed in today's reading is that God creates to bring order out of chaos. That the process of creation is orderly and systematic and not random and haphazard. Though sometimes we might think, okay, life seems to be random and haphazard. So as children of God, we're to continue God's work of creation to bring order out of chaos. We're to use the gift of our minds and our intellect to systematically bring order to the chaotic world, especially our corner of the world. And we see that God creates by beginning with the simple words, we're told God says, "Let there be light." And boom, there was light. We who are created in the image of God have the power of words also, that our words can kill the soul of another by insulting or disappointing them. Our words can kill our own personal soul by telling our own selves lies that we're no good or that we're supremely good, equal to God. So we're called to use our words carefully because it has the power to create and build up, but the power to destroy. And when God said, "Let there be light," that light includes us. Jesus tells us that we are the light that's not supposed to be hidden under a bushel basket. And finally, unlike many of the other cosmologies where, you know, their notion of God's creates the universe as their playground that they can play with, this is not what we find in Genesis. Rather, creation is orderly and for a purpose. And we'll find that purpose on the sixth day and the seventh day, so stay tuned. And so we gather this day to praise and worship the one God who brought order out of chaos and empowers us to continue God's work of creation in the world, to be that light created for the world. Let there be light. Let us stand and bring our needs and our concerns to our loving God. We pray for Pope Francis. We pray that God's Spirit be upon him to give him strength and wisdom, that he may be a source of unity, a source of light in this world. For this we pray. We pray for leaders of our world, and the world still torn by violence, by refugees, by human trafficking. May the leaders of our world work for justice for all people, especially those persecuted. May all people be lifted up. For this we pray. We pray for President Biden, for his administration, for great wisdom, as numbers of people seeking refuge from oppression in Central America and beyond that are coming to our borders. May President Biden be filled with wisdom to how to help these who are in need, but in a just and fair way. For this we pray. We pray for all the victims of human trafficking. We pray through the intercession of St. Josephine that they may find rescue and find freedom. For this we pray. We pray for all those who are sick. May they find comfort, especially those with COVID or COVID-related diseases. May they find healing and comfort. For this we pray. We pray for the success of the SEEK conference, that 25-plus thousand students and young adults and parishioners attended. May it bear much fruit. May the Spirit of and the love of God bear much fruit in people's hearts who attended, that they may be truly lights in our world. For this we pray. We pray for those who've died. We pray for Bob Hunka, one of our 7:30 a.m. Mass parishioners, who unexpectedly died this morning. And then today we're asked to remember Carla Chervin, the niece of Carla de Sola. So we pray for her and all those who've died. May they reap the reward and the peace of God in heaven. For this we pray. Loving and gracious God, on this feast day of St. Josephine Bakhita, through her intercession, may we always value freedom. May we always work for justice. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. For through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Better mission, water, or initiative in Christ, to share our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. For through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it would become our spiritual drink. Lord, wash away my iniquities and cleanse me of my sins. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we proclaim your wonders, O Lord, and the Virgin Blessed Josephine, we humbly implore your majesty that as her merits are pleasing to you, so too our dutiful service may find favor in your sight, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For in the marvelous confession of your saints, you make your church fruitful with strength ever new, and offer us sure signs of your love. And that your saving mysteries may be fulfilled, their great example lends us courage. Their fervent prayer sustains us in all we do. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as in exaltation we acclaim, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and our sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. There is one thing I ask of the Lord, only this do I seek, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Let us pray. Renewed by partaking of this divine gift, we pray, O Lord our God, that by the example of Blessed Josephine, bearing in our body the death of Jesus, we may strive to hold fast to you alone, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord with your life.